Dear students, welcome to this third lecture on study of Pila Globosa. In previous lectures, we studied about the introduction to the phylum Mollusca, general characters of the Mollusca. Then we looked at the systematic position of Pila, that is apple snail, with regions, as well as we studied the distribution, habits, and habitat of Pila Globosa. Now in today's lecture we are going to deal with Pila Globosa, external characters of the apple snail. So let's begin with this lecture number 3. So this, after completing this lecture, you should be able to know the structure of shell of Pila Globosa, histology of the shell of Pila Globosa, structure of the operculum, external characters of Pila Globosa, structure of head, foot, and visceral mass. So, as we know, apple snail or Pila belongs to gastropods, and in gastropods, shell is composed of single piece, that is univalved and spirally coiled. So, if you could see, there is a presence of single wall and it is spirally coiled. Okay, here you can see more clearly that it is the spirally coiled shell. So normally any shell in gastropod is elongated and hollow, spirally coiled around the central axis called as columella. So this central axis is known as columella, around which the shell is spirally coiled. And in gastropods, we always have a unilocular type of a shell. So here you could see the structure of this columella or the central axis. Okay, again here, though this is not the shell of Pila, here you could clearly see the central axis, that is known as columella. So they have, the Pila or apple snail has a single coil of a shell which is coiled round the axis in the form of whorl. And this central axis we have seen in previous slide, there is a central axis around which this is coiled, that is known as columella. Now further, this central axis, which we called it as columella, it may be hollow or it can be solid. But in case of Pila, the columella is perforated and it is hollow. Okay, so remember, it is hollow in case of Pila. Okay, here you can see different color variation in the Pila shell. Okay, now we come to the structure of shell in Pila Globosa. So the shell, we know that it is the protective outer covering present in the these mollusks, and it is somewhat globular in shape. Of the shell is globular in shape, and it is about 60 millimeter wide. Okay, so it is 60 millimeter wide, and the color varies from yellow to brown in color. So it can be yellow, light brown to dark brown as well. It depends on the habitat of that particular Pila snail. Further, it is univalved. Always it is univalved or unilocular. So what is mean by univalved? That means it is form of a single piece. Unilocular means it is undivided. So inside there is no division. There is a single one large space. And it have long hollow cone formed around a spiral central axis. So we know spiraled clockwise or anticlockwise, but most of the time it is clockwise, and that type of a shell is also known as dextral shell, or it is also called as a right-handed shell. So in case of Pila, 95% of the shells are dextral or clockwise, whereas very few, that is 5% of the shell, are sinistral type. Sinistral is exactly opposite to this, that means left-handed, or anti-clockwise type. So based on the coiling, we classified them into two types, that is dextral or sinistral. Columella we already know, that is in the central axis of the shell. Now, as we know that the shell of phyla is coiled, there are various coils of the shell which are called as whorls. And there are 3 to 4 whorls. You go from top to the bottom, the type or the size of the whorl increases. So the apex whorl is smallest, then you have the medium size, then you have the largest whorl. So the top of the shell is also called as apex of the shell. This is the oldest and the first form part of the shell. Okay, so remember that apex is the first form and the oldest part of the shell. Then below the apex here you can see is slightly larger type of a whorl. This is known as penultimate whorl. So this penultimate whorl is larger than the apex and it is followed by the largest whorl, that is known as body whorl. And most of the body of phyla is enclosed inside this body whorl. Now in between you can see there are some lines. These lines are called as sutures. And internally all the whorls of the shell, they can freely communicate with one another shell. Okay, so there is no partition between these whorls of the shell, so they can easily communicate. So these large body whorl can communicate with penultimate shell whorl, and this penultimate whorl can communicate with the apex whorl. So now this, we come to the mouth of the shell. This is the opening of the shell, which is lunate oblong type of a aperture, and it is called as a mouth or also called as aperture. So if we summarize, this opening portion of the shell is nothing but the mouth. It is also called as aperture. It is bounded by two lips, and this entire portion is also referred to as a this margin of this entire portion is called as peristome, and the mouth is bound by the two lips, the outer lip and the inner lip. The inner lip is also called as a columellar lip. Okay, now we move to the next part of our discussion, histology of the shell. The shell is composed of three layers. What are these three layers? The outer layer is known as periostracum, middle layer is known as ostracum, or it is also called as prismatic layer, and the innermost layer is known as hypostracum, or it is also called as mother of pearl. So in this picture we can see the different layers of the shell. So the outer layer, that is periostracum, then you have middle layer, that is ostracum, it is also referred to as a prismatic layer, and the innermost layer, it is also called as hypostracum or nacreous layer, or sometimes also referred to as mother of pearl. And below this third, that is hypostracum, you have the presence of epidermis. So this is the inside of the shell and this is the external side of the shell. So this periostracum is the outermost layer, which is thin and pigmented layer. If we see the chemical composition of this outermost layer, it is composed of quinone, a tanned horny protein material, which is also called as concholine or conchin. So it is mainly made up of proteinous in nature. Then it is lemon yellow to greenish brown in color. So this concholine basically giving this peculiar color to the outermost layer of the shell. Now it has to be very tough, so it is rough and protective in function, and it protects the lower layers from corrosive effect of carbonic acid in water. So this is the strongest layer of the shell, which protects the below layer of the shell from the carbonic acid. Sometimes water can have the traces of this carbonic acid and it can cause decay of the shell. So due to presence of this concholin, a protective protein, the shell is protected from this carbonic acid. Now we move on to the middle layer, the ostracum or the prismatic layer. This is the thickest layer of the shell. So remember, the middle layer is the thickest layer, called as ostracum, and it composed of calcium carbonate and concholin running at right angles to the mouth of shell. Okay, so it has two chemical components now, that is calcium carbonate and concholin. Together they are running at right angles to the margin of the mouth of shell. And so these two compounds form plate-like structures. So this each plate is surrounded by protein matrix, which give the strain to the shell. So this proteinaceous material, that is concholin along with the calcium carbonate, give the strain to the shell. Now we move on to the middle or the innermost, not middle. Now we move on to the innermost layer of the shell, which is known as hypostracum, nacre, or also called as mother of pearl. So this is innermost layer, which is also made up of plates of calcium carbonate, and these plates are arranged parallel to the margin of opening of mouth, that is aperture. Beneath this layer lies the mantle or the fold of a skin. Okay, so we'll be studying this in detail. And mantle is responsible for secretion of shell. So remember, this is very important, that mantle, a thin skin fold, is responsible for the secretion of shell. And where it is present? Below the hypostracum, that is the innermost layer of the shell. Okay, so this is all about the histology of the shell. Now we come to the operculum. So what is operculum? It is the lead like structure. Okay, so this lead like structure is present at the peristome, that is the opening of the mouth. So whenever the snail finds any danger, it can take the body inside the shell, and it covers the shell with the help of this operculum. So it can withdraw the body inside the shell when disturbed, or if it find any danger, and closes the mouth tightly by a thin flat lid. So it is a lid like structure, like you have the lid of the bottle. Similarly here it is like a lid of the body. Now it is attached dorsally to the foot. Okay, so always remember this. Where is this operculum present? It is present as an attachment to the foot. Now it is made up of calcareous plate, that is mean by it is made up of calcium carbonate, and it also comprises of cuticular secretion of glandular cells of the foot. Okay, so it is made up of these two components. Now if we see the structure of this operculum, the inner side and outer side, now it will have two margin, that is outer surface and inner surface. So those have the difference in their structure. So what is that difference? The outer, now here first we'll see, this is the outer view of the operculum. So from outside you can see operculum like this, and from the inner side, from the body of my pila shell, from the inner side it has the view like this. So from outer side you can see such concentric layers. Such layers are, or rings are, called as the rings of growth. Okay, so these, more the number of ring present in the operculum, more is the age of that particular animal. Now if we see the inner surface, from the inner side, at the center it shows some elevated elliptical area at the center, which is creamy color. It is called as boss. Okay, so two features you have to remember, that from outer surface you have these rings of growth, and from the inner side you have this creamy elliptical area, that is called as boss. Now the movement of this operculum is guided by the muscles. So these muscles of the operculum are attached to this area that is called as boss. So what is the significance of this region? That the muscles of the operculum are attached to this boss. Okay, now we move on to the next part of our lecture, the external characters of pila or apple snail. Now if we carefully remove the shell of the pila snail and the body is exposed, the body is differentiated into three parts. In the next slide we'll see that head, visceral foot and visceral mass. So these are the three regions in the body, and head and foot are protruded from the shell for creeping purpose, but visceral mass always remains within the shell. Okay, so always remember that whenever the snail is moving on the ground, only the foot and the head is coming out of the shell. Remaining body mass always remains inside the shell. So whatever this body mass is called as the visceral mass. Now the body is very soft, slimy, and it is lodged, means it is situated within the shell. Body is attached to the columella by a muscle. That muscle is called as a columellar muscle. And from where this muscle is arising? From the foot. Now what are the functions of this columellar muscle? This muscle prevents the animal from extending out of the shell beyond certain limit, because only the head and foot should come from the shell, not the entire body should come out of the shell. Otherwise the shell will get separated from the body. So to prevent that, this muscle is present. Also it helps to withdraw it into the shell. Okay, so suppose for feeding purpose it comes out of the shell, that means the head and the foot comes out of the shell, but after again it has to go inside the shell, then this muscle will help to again retract the body in the shell. And always in animal, only remember that only foot and head comes out of the shell, and visceral entire body mass always remains inside the shell for entire period. Okay, so here we see that body of the pila is divided into three parts, that is head, foot and mantle. Now we'll study each one in detail. Before that, you can see this picture where you will see this entire body mass. This is nothing but the visceral mass which remains inside the shell for the entire time, and this foot and the head region only comes out of the shell for the feeding. Now in this view you can see the ventral foot, you can see the tentacles, two pair of tentacles as we studied in the last lecture, as well as the one pair of eye. Okay, so now we will study the first part of the body, that is head. So head is the anterior most fleshy and bilaterally symmetrical region of the body. It is prolonged into the contractile snout. So this snout is the portion near the head and from which arises the two pair of tentacles. Okay, so there are two pair of tentacles. The first pair of tentacle is called as labial palps, which are small and lie in the front position. After that, you have second pair of tentacles, which are situated behind these labial palps. These are longer and highly contractile structures. So in previous slide, we have seen that the one pair of tentacles is larger. Okay, so that is the second pair, and we have the smaller pair that is known as labial palp, which is situated near the mouth. Now these tentacles are the hollow structures, and they are capable of extension and contraction. So with the help of which they can reach out to their exterior environment. Now behind the tentacles, the head has pair of eyes on tips on stalks, which are known as omentophores. So there are stalk-like structures on which the eyes are present, and those stalk-like structures are nothing but called as omentophores. Okay, now we move on to the structure of foot. Below the head is large, muscular and highly extensible foot, because it can come out of the body easily. How is the shape? It is triangular in shape, and the apex is pointing backwards. It is a flat structure, quite broad, triangular in shape, and smooth and gray colored. Lower surface it has, that lower surface we have seen in previous picture, called as sole of the foot. Now this sole, that is triangular part, is used for the creeping. Okay, so we have seen the snails, they show the creeping behavior. Now this foot is further divided into two parts. The anterior part is called as propodium, and the posterior part is called as metapodium. This posterior metapodium bears operculum, and what is the function of foot? It is locomotory organ, as well as for attachment to the substratum. Because it is living in the aquatic environment, sometime it might need to attach to the some substratum or solid surface. That time also foot is helpful, as well as it is responsible for the creeping movement of the animal. It is very or highly contractile, and the muscles are crosswise in structure, so they can easily aid in the contraction of the foot. And when foot is withdrawn inside the shell, operculum, that outer lid-like structure, closes the mouth of shell. Now there are specialized type of glands which are called as pedal mucus glands, which are present in the foot, and they are responsible for the slime trail. So you must have seen, when a snail passes by, you find a shiny mucus trail, that is known as slime trail, which is formed during the locomotion, and the responsible glands are called as pedal mucus glands. Now if you observe the movement of a snail or pila, there is a like wave of contraction which moves from the anterior end to the posterior end of the foot, and due to this wave like contraction, the power is generated for the movement or locomotion of the animal. Now there is no such clear cut distinction between the head and foot, but rather this head and foot together form a complex, which is also sometimes referred to as a head foot complex, and this is connected to the visceral mass, or the whatever organs they constitute this visceral mass, and which is present inside the shell. And this head and foot complex is connected by a short neck-like structure. Now we move on to the last part of the body, that is visceral mass. So what is mean by visceral mass? So visceral mass is the entire body mass of the organism, which contains all the main organs of the organism, and it is present above the head foot complex. It fills all the walls of the shell. So we have seen that there are three shells, that is the apex shell, penultimate shell and the body wall. All these three shells are filled with this visceral mass, which has all the important organs of the animal. It is spirally coiled like the shell to fit in it. Now we have seen the structure of shell, which is spirally coiled. Similarly, this visceral mass also should be spirally coiled, then only it is going to fit in the shell. It is a spirally coiled structure. And it is sort of hump on the dorsal side. So on the ventral side, you have the foot, and on this dorsal side, this you have this hump-like structure, means this globular structure. And it is that this visceral mass, this is responsible for the phenomena of torsion, which is distinct from coiling. So we have seen what is mean by this torsion in the previous lecture, which is nothing but the 180 degree movement of the visceral mass. And finally, if we see the color of this visceral mass, it is soft and gray to dark brown in color. Okay, so we know that these are the soft bodied animals, so whatever organs and the body mass is very soft, and it is lodged inside the shell, and it is dark brown in color. So if we summarize today's lecture, we first studied the structure of the shell, then we understood what are the layers in the shell, that is histology of the shell, the composition of these three layers. Then we move on to the external body characters of the pila globosa. In that we studied the head, foot and the visceral mass, how is their structure and what is their function. So with this we conclude today's fourth lecture on study of pila globosa. I thank you for your patience hearing.